Okay, so today we'll get more technical. Last time we were waxing and waning lyrically. One comment, as I said already in my email, this is a book that I'm writing on the stuff that Francis Crick and I've done over the last decade. And the book is as you see, it's in pretty good shape, but not quite ready yet. So I'm very grateful for anybody if you tell me about inaccuracies, infelicities, other errors, typos, although those are not so important, but mainly if things aren't really explained well, or if they're confusing, or if I made a mistake or something, and please do let me know. I very much appreciate that. Okay, so as we talked last time, the strategy thing has to, if you want to understand the neuronal basis of the brain-mind-body, how the physical brain can, how any physical system, in particular our brains, can generate these subjective feelings, a frontal assault has not proven very worthwhile over the last 2,500 years. We really have not made a lot of progress by having a frontal assault to try to come to grips with the most difficult problem, which is the problem where you have this explanatory gap. How is it that any physical system can have these subjective states? And right now, most people are just as puzzled, totally puzzled by it, how this could be, and the various reaction to that, from sort of throwing up your hands and walking away in disgust that science can never solve it, to making principled claims about you need new types of sciences. Our reaction is sort of, well, let's not worry about that right now. That's the most difficult problem, and usually, you don't win a war by fighting the most difficult battle first. But let's focus on something that's well within today's scientific and technological undertaking, which is to focus on the NCC, the specific neuronal correlates of consciousness. So what we're interested in are the minimal mechanism. Minimal because we know the entire brain is sufficient, right? If you take a well-rested brain, like my brain or your brains, and then we know that that's sufficient to be conscious. So we're interested in something much more specific. We're interested in the specific, in the smallest sort of, what's the smallest part of the brain that I can put in a dish, as it were, in order for this brain, isolated brain, to be conscious? That's a question we're asking. I think it's a precisely formulated question. Now, many people say that doesn't make sense, that the only way to understand the brain is to take the entire, to take the entire holistic brain. But as I mentioned last time, the great success of biology, particularly of molecular biology and cell biology over the last 100 years, has proven the idea that things are not holistic. I mean, yes, they're complicated, highly interrelated, highly interconnected systems, but they're always, at the base of them, are discrete mechanisms, very fancy mechanisms, incredible specific mechanisms. So you've got a proofreading mechanism, to go from DNA to RNA to proteins, and the proofreading mechanism sometimes makes mistakes. So you have a proof editing mechanism that edits a proof editing mechanism. And so you have these gadgets upon gadgets, and that's what biology is. And so likewise, it's well possible that there are some very specific mechanisms that underlie any one specific conscious percept. And again, the strategy is not to worry too much about the distinction between, let's say, the sleeping brain or the dreaming brain and the awake brain, or the brain in coma or in a persistent vegetative syndrome as in a patient, and the awake brain, because those are general factors. There's going to be a range of general factors that we're beginning to understand. There is this host of nucleus in the brainstem that need to be active in order for you to be awake and aware and to be able to learn and process information. But we're interested in the much more specific. You take an awake brain like yours, and then I show you this illusion I showed you last time. Sometimes you see it, sometimes you don't see it. Where's the difference? So where's the difference? What are the minimal neuronal mechanisms to give rise to a specific percept, like seeing yellow spots or hearing a high tone or feeling pain or being conscious that you're you? Okay, so there's a few principles that I think it's really important that people have learned over the last 20 years about the brain, and we will summarize them briefly today from a theoretical perspective, and then the next week we'll give a little primer about the brain. We'll start with the retina, the eyes, on Wednesday, and of which a lot, of course, is known. They're sort of the basis of seeing. You don't see a lot. You can see without your eyes, of course. You can imagine and you can dream visually, but normal vision requires eyes, and we know a lot about the eyes and a lot of interesting relationships at the eye, the level of the eye already, that relate to the way you see. or the way you don't see the world. Yet the conclusion from that lesson will be that we don't see with the eyes, that the eyes are necessary to take up the visual information, convert the incoming photons into energy, into electrical potential, action potential that can be then understood by the rest of the brain, but that you do not see with the eyes. In other words, the neural activity in your eyes does not correspond at all to the way you see the world. And that's, I think, most everybody will agree with that. And then on Friday, we'll talk more about primary visual area, the part of the brain, at the, as I mentioned here, at the back of your head, sort of as a prototypical cortical area. So today, we will just briefly allude to some of those things. And as always, everything I say is in the chapter 2, all the references also. So it's become popular. Many of you will have seen functional imaging images. Some of you might have any of you had your brain scanned? Oh, only one. Well, in fact, next Monday, you see this outside this missile silo hole, you know, they've taken out. So next Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, there'll be a huge crane there, and we're going to get our magnet, or the three magnets are going to be delivered. And next Monday, Tuesday, there'll be the first magnet delivered. It's going to be lifted just like a missile into the silo down there. And so starting in a month from now, we can do functional imaging experiments in humans, in normal subjects. And for that, we're also going to look for volunteers. So anybody who wants to see their brain, then you can put it like me on your website, and you can put it on your business card. I've got my brain on my business card, yes. anyhow, so all of that, over the last 10 years, because this huge explosion in functional imaging, it's of course very sexy, and you can get on the front page of the New York Times, but it's led many people into this down the false road that in order to understand, I mean, it's a great tool, But people believe now that we can understand the brain because we can see big chunks of it being active. You know, you typical experiment, you look at a moving stimulus and you look at a stationary stimulus, and I compare the two and I can pinpoint the part of the brain that's active at some level, whatever active means, that's active when for motion perception. Or I can look at a colorful stimulus, and I can look at the same stimulus, black and white, and then again I can look at the difference, and I can pinpoint areas in the brain where there's neurons that specifically concern about color. On the other hand, what you see there, given the technique, both from a technological point of view as well as from the fundamental scientific point of view, you're imaging. You're looking at hemodynamics. You're looking at blood hemodynamics. You're looking at the fact that if neurons are active, they require a lot of energy. If synapses are active, if neurotransmitter, you know, comes to a synaptic terminal, releases synapses that triggers electrical activity on the other side, on the next neuron, all that costs energy, metabolic energy. That energy is supplied through oxygen and hemoglobin, and essentially you can, there's this great thing that deoxygenated blood has different magnetic properties from oxygenated blood. Just like, you know, if you've ever cut your arteries and veins, you can see they have slightly different color, right? The deoxygenated blood is a little blue, the other one is more redder. So likewise, they have slightly different magnetic properties, and essentially you have this internal contrast agent in your head, and we can make use of that. So essentially what you're doing, it's a bit like an analogy, like you're trying to understand people from space, but you don't have the technique to image individual people. So instead what you're doing, you're tracking their power consumption. That would be the analogy. You know, so you're tracking the fact that, for example, you know, in summer, there's this high power consumption, particularly in the evening when people get home. So you see this big surge on the electrical grid because people come home, turn on the air conditioner. And, you know, so that's a little bit the analogy. With this technology, this fictitious technology, you couldn't track the movement of an individual. You can just track sort of the movement of a large number of people. Likewise here, with this fMRI technique, you can track the activity of probably on the order of 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6 neurons. So, you know, 100,000 to a million neurons, very large bodies of neurons that you're tracking here, which is great, but it's very, very crude, and one should never forget that. While the true action really resides at the level of individual neurons, and neurons are incredibly heterogeneous. They're not alike. They're not just positive and negative neurons, like excitatory neurons and inhibitory neurons. There are probably between 100 and 1,000 different cell types, and they connect in very, very specific patterns, very specific patterns. So just like in molecular biology, we've gotten used to the fact that you cannot lump all, you know, globular proteins into one class and compare them with sort of, you know, with sheath-like proteins. That doesn't make any sense. You really need to track individual, you know, one individual type of protein among 100,000. Same thing you need to do with neurons. You really need to know about individual neurons. And so in that sense, neurons are the basic, they're the atoms out of which sort of perception, action, thought, and memories are built. we really need to look at level of neurons. Now, neurons communicate with other neurons. I'll talk about it using this pulse code I mentioned already. Screen. So if you're putting your electrode, so you have this piece of wire that you put next to, let's say, a neuron here. This is a typical neuron in cortex. You know, when people talk about their gray cells here, what they mean are these cells. They're called pyramidal neurons because this looks, the cell body here looks a little bit like a pyramid. And roughly 2/3 or 70% of all the cells in your cortex proper are pyramidal neurons. And let's say you put an electrode here, and then you can pick up electrical signal and amplify them. And then typically what you see at a high scale, you see something that looks like a little bit like this. So this might be, this might be here on the order of 1 millisecond, 0.5 to 1 millisecond. And this might be here on the order of 100 millivolt. This is called a spike or an action potential. And this is the basic currency of the forebrain, of cortex and thalamus and all the associated structure. These little pulses, they're fairly stereotypical in one neuron and also different types of neurons in different animals. You know, we record from humans, and you compare those action potential against action potential in a fly, and they don't look much different. So this is the basic, that's how all nerve cells in most creatures work, not in all creatures. They're very small. In some creatures, or in some parts of the brain, the communication is also analog. So this is a pulse code, a pulse-triggered code, right? So if you look at over time scales, let's say of 1 second, you see this. So these are these unitary pulses, and what really counts is, well, we don't know. This is now the question of the code. What's the neural code that's being used to communicate? And there's probably no universal code, but the code probably depends on which animal or which part of the brain in particular might differ from different tasks. But one thing you can do, and most people do, you can just count how many pulses there are. So you say, well, over this, let's say 200 milliseconds, there were 5 pulses, right? So the neuron fires, on average 25 times a second at 25 hertz. Or you can say, well, it really matters the fact that these have certain intervals, or that here that you have groups of 3, and here you have groups of 2. So there are many more fancy codes. We'll briefly allude to them today. So that's a question of the code, but we all agree that this is the universal currency of communication used among neurons. Now there are exceptions. For example, in the retina, on some other parts of the brain, neurons can also communicate integrated in an analog manner. It's called dendrodendritic synapses, and there are special neurons that communicate, particularly over short distances, in an analog way. And in some animals, like in the C. elegans, the roundworm, the one that was first sequenced a few years ago, that animal is only a millimeter or so, or 2 millimeters across. So there, for example, those animals don't seem to have these action potentials at all. But certainly in large creatures, and certainly in the brain proper, most of the communication seems to involve these action potentials, these pulses. So that's what you have in order to explain how you think and how you see and how you feel. It all has to come out of, somehow has to arise out of this. So that's also the fundament. So there are a lot of theories by sort of philosophers or by some physicists, so-called field theories. So they claim in order to explain the brain, even some neuropsychologists, that in order to understand the brain, there's this consciousness field. And this field sort of permeates all the brain. The trouble with that is if you look at the physical carrier of that, the electropotential field. So, yes, if this is the brain, you have all your neurons here. You have this incredible dense neuropil where they're on the order of 100,000 cells per cubic millimeter. You put an electrode in here. Yes, you can see a field. There's the electrical potential. Usually it's very small, so it's like a millivolt or a tenth of a millivolt, usually even. I mean, this is when it's intercellular. When you record it outside here, this signal might be, let's say, 0.1 millivolt. Or very often can be, 0.0, 20 microvolt or something like that. 20 microvolt, 0.02 millivolt. So the trouble with all these fields, the fundamental problem is that all these field theories face or don't really face up to is the fact that the extracellular potential is very, very small and is unlikely to affect other neurons indirectly, except for a few exceptions like in epileptic seizures when you've got the entire brain that fires away, you know, rhythmically, and then it's well possible that that the extracellular potential can directly communicate information. But otherwise, the only way to rapidly and specifically for this neuron to talk to this neuron is it has to send an output, one of these pulses along this action along this axon, and the axon, you know, has to make a synapse here on the this is the dendrite. And the axon has to make a synapse here onto this dendrite. And the action potential goes here, is converted into a chemical signal, and then it's reconverted into electrical signals. So you've got the electrical, chemical, electrical conversion from electrical signal back into electrical signal. That's the only way you have to communicate using these spikes. As I said, you can direct, I mean, there is this direct coupling, but that's very, very, very small and causally, it's probably little causal effect with possible some exceptions like epileptic seizure, which of course it's a pathological condition. It's not a normal condition of the brain. So that's why I think all these field theories are sort of a no-go, because there's just no physical substrate there to enable you to communicate. Okay. Next thing is a key concept, is the receptive field. The receptive field. Is this clear? Questions? No questions? Okay, so what you can do this in any sensory system, and has been done, but by far the most popular system is the visual system for various reasons, partly because we ourselves are very visual creatures, partly because it's very easy to manipulate the visual system, particularly using monitors. You can very precisely give images, you can manipulate them, they're very rich in meaning. There's 200 years of tradition of visual psychology. There's, you know, a long tradition of visual physiology. We have a very good animal model for human vision, namely monkey vision. It's very similar. And there's a fairly big literature on understanding the computations involved in vision. That's why vision sort of, for many, and you have all these wonderful visual illusions where you can precisely manipulate what's physically present, the input to the system, and what you actually see. And none of that, you can't do any of those as well in other modalities. That's why just vision tends to be the most popular system. So what you do, you can do it in humans, but it's rarely done in humans, usually do it in animal. You get the animal, for example, to fixate at this, you know, fixate this location, and let's say you record from the retina, or you record from a primary visual cortex, so you stick your electrode into the brain. You can do that because in the brain itself, of course, there are no pain receptors. Although, ironically, the brain is where pain gets generated, right? You don't, you know, if I squeeze myself, I don't feel pain here. I feel pain in my somatosensory or my anterior cingulate cortex, although I project it back onto my finger, but, you know, I don't feel the pain. I mean, the pain sort of is generated here. But ironically, the brain itself has no pain receptors. So you get the animal to look here, and then, for example, you record from a neuron, and then you notice that you take, for example, this piece of chalk, and you move it about. I mean, so what I'm symbolizing is that you're recording from the neuron, you're putting this amplified action potential on an audio monitor so you can listen to them, and so you can do this. This is how it used to be done. Now it's done, of course, computerized, but people still do that because it's very useful. So you can listen, what is the trigger feature of that particular neuron? And you discover every time you move something in this part of the visual space, the neuron responds. Well, if you move it anywhere else, it doesn't respond. So then after a while, you say, okay, this is its receptive field. The key concept can be applied to any other domain, receptive field in space. So this is in XY. So in other words, this neuron sort of looks out, if you want, this neuron sort of looks out at that part of visual space, and if you put something in it, it fires. And now you can see, for example, it's more specific than that. It will really only like, if let's say we're in primary visual cortex, it will only like things that have an orientation. So if you just put a flash of light, if you just focus and flash on, it won't fire a lot. But what it really likes are bars. And then you might discover, well, the bar has to be a certain orientation. If it's this orientation, it fires. If it's this orientation, it fires much less. If it's this orientation doesn't fire at all. Or, depends what neuron you're, you might discover it has to be about this orientation moving in this direction. So it fires, and it hardly fires in this direction. Now, of course, this is biology, so it's very often, and so it fires, you know, it might fire in the other direction, but much, much less. So you can discover what are the trigger features. what are the trigger features that excite this neuron? And you might, depending where it is in the retina, for example, neurons don't care about orientation. Retina neurons care mainly about points or circles of light. It's a bit like a Pontius painting, in the, let's say, 1880s, 1890s, when people painted with these, I guess, sort of early impressionism. So there, the retina cares about little splotches of light, little circles of light, or the dark sometimes. Dark is sometimes equally attractive. On a grayscale background, if you make it darker, the neuron might fire, or if it's lighter, it might fire. Those are called on or off neurons. While, for example, in cortex in humans and in monkeys, cortex cares about things like motion, cares about things like certain depth. So you put the same piece of gray here or here, the neuron might only fire if you put it far away. Or other neurons care about color. Other neurons care about, smells, or they care about auditory stimulus. They care about certain tones. So you can characterize each neuron by its sort of generalized receptive field, not only in space, but in color space, or in depth space, or in olfactory space, or in frequency space for auditory input. And as I sort of alluded to already, as you go up, as you walk up to higher stages, you start off in the early part of the retina, then you go to an intermediate Wallace station called the thalamus, you go to visual cortex. As you go to higher stages, these receptive field properties become more elaborated. They become more complex. Including, I'll show you in a second, in high parts of the brain, you might find neurons that really don't care about those low-level things at all, but they only fire, let's say, two faces. Or the face has to be upright. If you put the face upside down, it won't fire anymore. Or they might only fire to this view and to this view, but the neuron will not fire to this view or to this view. Or they might fire only to specific individuals. So let me come to that. So now here's this very important theoretical concept of explicit versus explicit, what's on there? Explicit versus implicit coding, which I think is critical for consciousness. So here, for example, you have a neuron that's in a fairly high-level part of the brain. We'll talk about brain architecture next week, in 10 days from now, where this exactly is. But it's in a fairly high-level part of the brain called the AMTS, infratemporal cortex, for those of you who care. And it's an awake monkey recorded in the lab of Nikos Logothetis in Germany. And this monkey was trained to, believe it or not, but discriminate paperclips. Okay, they choose paperclips because they wanted something that the monkey would not be familiar with. So this animal was trained incredibly well, much better. So it's lit. I mean, these are computer generated, but essentially, I don't have a paperclip here. Maybe there's one here. Yeah, there is. So essentially, literally, this monkey was trained, for example, to fire to this paperclip from all angles and to discriminate this paperclip from this paperclip or from this or from this. Okay, now, it's a non-trivial task, and I mean, this probably would be very difficult to get humans to do this. I mean, you would have to pay them a lot of money, because it's, you can imagine, it's very boring. And now the monkeys, they do this for orange juice or for apple juice. And I guess you could do it with humans. And literally you train them on a task like this for 2 hours a day, maybe for half a year, sort of 7 days a week. But I mean, humans, of course, can do similar things if they're motivated enough, no question about it. And then what they found, which is quite remarkable, they found individual neurons in this high-level part. So early on, let's say in primary visual cortex, you might only have a neuron that responds just to this edge or just to this edge. Or it would only respond to this edge if it's oriented like this. But, like I said, if I turn it like this, the neuron will not fire anymore. But in higher stages of the brain, as you ascend, sort of there's a hierarchy, we'll talk about it. As you ascend this hierarchy, suddenly you find neurons, for example, this is all on the top level. It's all the same paperclip, and the paperclip is rotated. You view it from different angles. And then what you can see, it's pretty amazing, this neuron will only fire if the paperclip is viewed at one angle, minus 72 degrees. Well, if you turn it by 26 degrees one way or the other way, or 24 degrees, it fails to respond. I should mention, this is time. This is probably 1 second, or 800 milliseconds. And this is the firing rate. So here it's called a histogram, posthumous time histogram. It's just a condensed representation of these action potential where people just count how many action potential were fired. So, you know, early on there's, you know, here there's nothing in there, you know, a couple of action potential, the rate goes up, I don't know, maybe to 2 or 3 hertz, and then it sort of goes down to zero, you know. So essentially, this is sort of basically background rate. Here the muon doesn't fire at all. Here it fires like, I don't know, 2, 3, 4 spikes. But here you can see, it fires very vigorously for this one. Well, it fires, you know, it almost stopped firing if you just rotate it by 24 degrees one way, 24 degrees the other way. This is a pretty amazing specificity. These are view-specific neurons that only respond to one view of one particular paperclip. The paperclip that the monkey was trained, these are not just any random paperclips, but these are paperclips that the monkey was trained to discriminate. And these are other paperclips. So on the top row, you see always the same paperclip from the same angle. Here you see different paperclips. And you can see it doesn't respond at all to different paperclips. So this is what Crick and I call an explicit representation. It's difficult to define explicit rigorously in a computational way, although you could. But the idea is that let me try to make it clear with an example, the difference between explicit and its antonym implicit representation. So if you look at a TV monitor these days when you have newscast on 24 hours, and an explicit, let's think about face representation. What would be an explicit and what would be an implicit representation for faces? An explicit representation for face would be if you had a little LED that lights up whenever there was a face on the, you know, whenever they showed a human face on the TV screen. That would be an explicit face detector. Because now you could read off without any further computation, just when that red LED goes on, you know a face is present. You don't know where it is. You don't know who it is. You don't know whether they're angry or sad. You don't know anything. All you know that there's a face present. So that's an explicit face representation. And there are now computer vision programs that can basically do that to first order. In fact, one was built here at Caltech by Pietro Perona. An implicit face representation is what you have on the TV screen. If you actually look at the screen, you look at the pattern of the individual pixel, that's where you have an implicit representation of the face, right? All the information that you're ever going to get about the TV screen is in the pixels on the screen. Likewise, all the information your brain has accessible about, for example, my brain is accessible with this lecture hall, is encoded in the photoreceptor distribution on my right and my left retina, right? There are no other sources of visual information. Yet there's nothing is made explicit. Well, okay, I shouldn't say nothing, but interesting things like faces are not made explicit at the level of the retina. You have to do a huge amount of processing at the photoreceptor level to extract the fact that there's a face. Yet if you go to high enough stages in the brain, you do see such explicit detectors. And so this is one. This would be an explicit detector for one type, for one view of one type of paperclip. And and Crick and I believe that if you can directly see something, if you can directly perceive something, if you can directly hear or smell something, underlying it has to be a direct, explicit representation of that. Because there's nothing else, if you think about it, there's nothing else in the brain except neurons. And so if you can directly perceive a paperclip, it seems to us it has to from that follow that you have a direct neuronal representation, explicit neuronal representation of whatever you're seeing. So the assumption is that this is a necessary but not sufficient, it's a necessary condition for you to be conscious of something, is to have an explicit representation for that particular thing that you're conscious of. So in this case, these paperclip neurons could be, some of them, it's necessary but not sufficient, as I said, those paperclip neurons would probably be essential and a necessary ingredient in actually seeing in the conscious perception of this particular paperclip. Here, just to indicate, it's another neuron selected for another paperclip, or this is a neuron that's selected for a really weird three-dimensional amoeba-like shape. So it's if you train the animal, you can find this fairly common. And here again, you see that it has this nice tuning. So this is always the same three-dimensional blob shape. And you rotate it, you know, it has some invariance. But, you know, if you rotate it more than 30 degrees or 40 degrees in either way, sort of the neuron doesn't respond anymore. So these are fairly specific neurons. So once again, this argues against this sort of this computational soup this colloidal, these arguments that sometimes come from some people that are saying, well, neurons aren't specific enough to mediate the crisp. But, you know, perception is nothing but, it's incredibly crisp, right? I don't see a superposition of different things. I look out at the world, and within a fraction of a second, I see all of you. You're in color, you're in depth, you're in glorious sort of, you know, an all-glorious aspect of reality. You're there. You don't wane in and out of existence. I see you all very vividly. And so people have this feeling, well, neurons can mediate that very specific. But if you look at individual neurons, you know, they have some very amazingly specific responses.
Do you think the same neuron can be reused to have different explicit representations, say a clown, but also at a certain orientation could be also recognized by the same neuron?
Okay, so that's a very good question. So I think... Okay, so the question was, can a neuron express different explicit representation, or can it be reused? So I think, of course, remember, think of it like burning a CD or RAM, right? Because the monkey literally, for 6 months, his survival depending on doing this task, right? So there's a huge impetus on the monkey to do this task correctly, and he dedicated, or its brain, however, did it automatically, dedicated those neurons. So I think, you know, if you now train the monkey, with a very different task, let's say with using, you know, different stimuli, the same task, I don't know, I think it's a purely empirical question, will this neuron rewire, or will you wire up new neurons? And probably it's a combination of the two, because I bet you, even if the monkey learns, he's still going to remember this, right? So in principle, I don't know, it could go either way. Now, of course, very often these, okay, so I shouldn't throw out the baby with the bathwater. Yes, there are these amazingly specific neurons, no question about it. On the other hand, there are also many neurons that are less specific. There are, for example, neurons that respond sort of pretty crudely to most things that will look roughly like this. There are some neurons like that. So this is the idea I wanted to now get to, population coding. So it's not that if I'm conscious of a paperclip, there are these 10 paperclip neurons that fire, and they constitute the neural correlate for my paperclip perception. It's probably much more much larger groups of neurons that are involved, some which are very specific and some which are much more broader. And some of those broader neurons could participate in many different percepts. So we know this for faces. Let me show you this for faces. Okay, this is one extreme. This is a neuron that we've recorded from Gabriel Kreimann did last 2 years ago as part of his PhD thesis. This is in human. It's very rare to record from human brain, but occasionally it becomes necessary for people who have epileptic seizures. And this is the seizure, and they have to be treated using surgical intervention. The drugs don't work anymore. And surgical intervention is actually very successful, and usually, much more often than not, the patient goes home and doesn't have any other seizure anymore, or the seizure sort of is dramatic, the incident of seizures are dramatically reduced. In some subset of those patients, roughly 30%, they can't detect where the seizure originates from outside. The structural MRI looks normal. The EEG, they can't tell whether it originates. Sometimes you can't even tell whether it starts on the left or in the right hemisphere. So then what you can do, the surgeon implants electrodes, up to 10 or 12 electrodes, into the brain of the patient. And those electrodes are then sealed in place. And then the patient goes to the ward of the hospital and stays there 2, 3, 4, 5 days, is monitored 24/7. And then the patient has seizures, a couple of seizures, and then you monitor those electrodes, you record where they are. And then essentially you can do triangulation, because now you have these electrodes that are inside the cortex proper, and so you can pinpoint the foci of the seizure very accurately. And then they take out the electrodes, and then the surgeon goes in, the neurosurgeon takes out, scoops out, or cuts out, or electrocoagulates the part of the brain that gives rise to the seizure. So when you have these big electrodes, no, they're not this big. They're probably more like this. When you put those into the brain, then what people do at UCLA, our collaborators, Dr. Itzhak Fried, he's the neurosurgeon who does that, he hollows out those microelectrodes and he inserts little microwires, just like essentially you would put in an experimental animal, except they're now in a human. And now you have 8, 10, 12 of these microwires in each of those big microelectrodes. So you can have 50, 60 wires now in a human head. And now you can essentially do the same as you showed you before. You can record individual neurons, and they look no different than other neurons. The action potential look no different than action potential from other animals, except now you're in a human brain, and the brain is conscious. Now, there are huge limitations. For once, you cannot move the electrode. Everything, of course, has to be done to assure the safety of the patient. Most importantly, you know, the electrodes are wherever the doctor deems it necessary, not where sort of I would like them to be. So there are lots of drawbacks to it, but it's a conscious human. So here you have this is in part of the brain, in the high-level part of the brain. You typically don't tend to have seizures in the back of the brain, for example, where your primary visual cortex is. Typically, you have seizures in part of the brain called the medial temporal lobe. That's where your memories, medial temporal lobe, are critically involved in information storage, in particular from short to long term. Or we record also in a part of the brain called the amygdala that's involved in perception of fear, or in high-level parts in the prefrontal cortex. That's where people tend to have seizures. Erin Schumann here at Caltech, she's doing something very similar with doctors at the Huntington. So here you have, this is 3 seconds. When the first dash is, an image comes on, this image comes on, which is removed when at the end of the second dash. It's on for 1 second. Let me just zoom in. So these are the 12 most, this is the same neuron, it just shows the 12 responses that were most vigorously. So the horizontal dashed line is background rate, it's like 2 hertz. So this neuron will, for whatever reasons we don't know, we don't understand, will fire roughly twice a second. So it isn't really excited about any of these patterns. But if you look at this gentleman, you know, William Clinton, our ex-president, Clinton with his wife and somebody else, and a line drawing of Bill Clinton, this neuron responds, I mean, you don't have to do any statistics to see that it responds highly significant compared with other famous males or, you know, females or animals. Also compared to, we showed it, other presidents like Washington or the Father Bush. Here you have a neuron that seems to respond very selectively to images of, at least to those 3 images of Clinton, yes?
How do you find a Clinton neuron? Because that's just a lucky chance.
Yes, it's a very good question. So it's, of course, evoked quite a bit of controversy, the Clinton neuron. It's not quite chance. I mean, this part of the brain seems to contain quite a bit of neurons that seem to be selective for things that you are very familiar with. So this was at the time, this recording was at the time of in the impeachment trial when Clinton was, you know, A, he was our president, and B, he was on the news because of the impeachment. And so so we know, we have other neurons that respond to, who's that famous basketball player? I keep on forgetting him. Yeah, Michael Jordan. We have a neuron that responds to one of the Beatles. We have one that responds to the Simpsons, the cartoon characters. So the idea, I mean, for my money is, I think this is a part of the brain where you're going to have lots of specific response to things that you're intimately familiar with and that you see every day. Like, you know, my family, my pet, my computer phone, my Macintosh, the people I work with, my cars, you know, all those things I see all the time. It's very, that there seem to be neurons that encode that. Yes? Okay, it's impossible to say. I mean, it would be extremely unlikely. It would boggle the mind if there's only one neuron. Because if you lose that neuron, you would lose the percept. And so I think that's arbitrary, unlikely. But so if you ask the question, well, how many are there? For things that you really see often, there might be hundreds of them. Now, they might not all encode the same thing. You know, some neurons might be more involved. For example, this neuron is in a part of the brain that seems to be involved in emotional reaction, particularly a negative emotional reaction like the amygdala. So maybe, you know, although we asked this patient, he didn't seem to have at the time, he didn't have any strong feeling for or against Clinton in either case. But we know, for example, when it faces, and this is what's typically about population coding, that different types of neurons in different parts of the brain that encode different aspects of face perception. So this seems to be mainly involved in identity. And we know, of course, a lot more in monkeys. I say, of course, because you can do, this is very rare in a monkey, you can do many more routines recording. So we know there are neurons in the monkey that encode for faces, identity. There seem to be neurons that encode for angle of gaze. We know there are neurons that seem to, we know from discrete brain damage in humans, there's a syndrome called prosopagnosia, the inability to recognize faces. And there are various forms of it. One is that you don't know a face is a face. You can see the eyes, you can see the ears and the mouth, but you cannot see a face. It's a bit difficult to understand. So there's nothing wrong with the visual system of this person, the early visual system. And like I said, the person can say it's an eye, it's an ear, but he's unable to put it together into a face percept. There are other cases where the person knows it's a face, but he doesn't know it's his wife of 30 years. until your point that, you know, she talks or he sees the moles, and then he knows, oh yeah, that mole is probably my wife. I mean, you might have read Oliver Sacks, the man who took his wife for a hat. So that's a case description of such a patient who was unable to perceive face, or he confused faces with other common day objects. So then there are some of these patients who can recognize a face, but who don't know the face is scared, or don't know the face is angry. So again, that tells us, and there are lesions in different parts of the brain, that tells us there are neurons there that seem to be specifically responsible for mediating, for reading off the emotional expression of a face. And this is a very common story in the brain, that the brain neurons are highly specialized. They're early on the generalist, but then they specialize, but they're also adaptive. So if you lose one part of the brain, you're young enough, particularly if you're younger than puberty, your other part of the brain can rapidly take over. You know, if I lose it in my brain, you know, at my age, I might have more difficulty. I would have to do a lot of training. But the fact is that there seem to be different parts of the brain that are involved in coding even what we think of maybe simple things like faces. And so you might have separate, you know, representation for the emotion, for the gender, for the hue, for the color of the face, for the hairline. All those things might well be coded by separate groups of neurons. And if you lose those discrete group of neurons, you do not have a general loss of face perception, but you might have a very specific loss of face perception. Like, say, you can see faces, but you cannot read the emotional expression. So this is what people mean by population coding. Population coding is a very broad and flexible term. It can be, you know, huge population, like, for example, we'll talk about color. Color is a population, and color uses a population principle, coding principle. You don't see color with a single photoreceptor. You need a population to see it. And with faces, there might be different populations. Some might be narrower, some might be broader. And so that gets back to the question that you asked. You know, some of those broad face neurons might be involved in seeing also famous faces like these ones that I know well, but also the salesman who just walked up to my front porch and I never saw him before. I would assume that those neurons are active in both cases. But then when I see Clinton or think of Clinton or maybe think of Monica Lewinsky or the White House or whatever, then maybe those neurons are active. We know from similar experiments, not with this particular neuron, but we know with these types of neurons, that if you're asked to think about them, so what Gabriel Kreiman did, he asked his patient, okay, now close your eyes and you remember the dolphin that you saw and that woman's face. Well, for 3 seconds, I want you to think about the dolphin. And now for 3 seconds, think about the woman's face. And then think about the dolphin again, okay? And then you can see some neurons have exactly the same selectivity. So in other words, if there's a neuron that happens to like the dolphin's face, but that doesn't fire, let's say, to that face of that woman up on top, then if you ask the person to close his eyes and imagine the dolphin, the neuron will fire much more strongly to a dolphin than to the face of the woman. In fact, you can read off, you can do sort of a code, a very simple form of mind reading in these very impoverished circumstances. You can read off, I can tell you, okay, without you telling me, I know now the neurons, I could do some simple mathematical analysis to tell you, okay, you are probably thinking now of the face and now you're thinking of the dolphin. So some of that representation for imagery and for vision with my eyes and imagery when I see with my mental eyes, it were, has the same substrate. Not all of it, but some we know the substrate is the same. The firing was less. And there's an interesting question there. Of course, the imagery is much less vivid, right? If I look at you, for example, if I look at your blue shirt there and then T-shirt, and then I imagine it, it's much, much fainter, right? But if you look at me, this red vest, and you close your eyes, you can probably imagine it. I mean, there's huge variability also among people. Some of you can probably imagine it more vividly than others, but the fact is it's all much, much less vivid than I'm actually looking at it. I mean, it seems so much richer. So it's not clear where that vividness comes from. No. Okay, so the question is, what did I mean by this representation is sufficient? So like I said, it's extremely unlikely that at least in cortex that one neuron is sufficient to do anything. I mean, a neuron by itself usually is not powerful enough by itself in cortex to vigorously cause a strong effect in the next neuron. You need groups of cells. An interesting question is how small? I mean, I think it could be small. It could be 100 or 1,000 cells rather than 10 to the 10 neurons. I mean, they're on the order of between 10 to the 10 to the 11 neurons. What I mean by sufficient is that right now, nobody has any idea what is necessary and sufficient. I mean, what's the minimal thing that's necessary and sufficient? My brain is necessary and sufficient. If my brain is there and it's intact and well-rested, it's necessary and sufficient to give rise to consciousness. But as I said, can somebody give me a minimal list of necessary and sufficient conditions? Nobody can. So right now we can just say the explicit representation is probably, I mean, it's a hypothesis, we don't know. But we would say it's probably likely to be necessary, but by itself not sufficient. There are other things that have to come in addition to in order to be sufficient for consciousness. And everybody's interested in those, but we don't know. We hope it's in the fullness of time, as the years accumulate to decades, that we will find out necessary and sufficient conditions. Here, for example, you have another phase neuron. This is in a monkey now that's much more broadly tuned. This is a particular person called David Leopold, who will be here next week, 10 days from now. We're trying to recruit him. And he trains monkeys, and so this monkey neuron was responding to him. Again, it's not surprising because this monkey sees this person every day for hours at end. So here is the representation again. This is between those two vertical lines is 1 second. And this is firing rate. And here you can see, in response to this vase, it fires weakly. It fires a little bit to this person looking to the left. Doesn't fire to these animal heads. Doesn't fire to this guy looking to the right. It fires David Leopold, but only in this case if the person looks towards the right or if he looks towards the left. Not full frontal view or not sort of, looking in back view. So again, it's just another neuron that seems to encode something. This neuron seems to encode something about the silhouette. Or maybe they didn't test it. Maybe it has to do where the eyes are looking. This is all in high-level parts of the brain. Does anybody know what this is? Yeah? It's from the Caltech. I got this from the Caltech. What's it called? Legends of Caltech or something. So let's see. If I remember the story is... I mean, I'll come to the scientific point in a second. The story is this was done in the 50s, I think, when there was some football game in the Rose Bowl. Yeah, between two teams, and they snuck in. So yeah, these cue cards, this was done in the 50s, apparently it was popular, where people at their seat had a card that was one bit, was either black or white, and then they had some complicated instructions that were passed on. They were supposed to spell out various letters, and I guess the message of the home team or whatever, I mean, something relating to the home team. And the Caltech sort of snuck into the hotel the night before and just changed the instructions. It's really like a virus. They took over the instructions, not the hardware itself, but they changed the... And, of course, as individual, you have no idea. As individual, all you have is your cue card. It's white and black, and all you do this based on... I don't know how the... based on these written instructions. With this symbol, with this sign, you're supposed to say this, and with this, when somebody screams this, you're supposed to show this. And so they spelled out this Caltech. I mean, it's not terrible high resolution, right? But I think if you blur your eyes, you can clearly see Caltech. And apparently it took him several minutes to realize that there was something funny going on. Why do I show this? Well, it's a nice example of population coding, right? Because if you look at the individual, and there's some nice analogy with action potential. So if you think about this cue card, this flash cue card, it's like an action potential. It's one bit. Okay, and one bit by itself, in this case, is relatively meaningless. And the meaning comes, of course, this is where the analogy breaks down and becomes downright dangerous. The meaning comes from the external observer, namely you, looking at this in your head, reconstructing the fact that it says Caltech. Now, of course, in the brain, there is nobody looking down. There is no homunculus in the brain, right? That's why this is a dangerous, somewhat altogether dangerous analogy. There is no other observer in the brain except some other neural network. Right, so In the way Crick and I think about it, it's actually the front of the brain is looking at the back of the brain, and we'll come to it specifically well what we mean. The front of the brain is looking at the back of the brain and processing it. You can do it without there being an infinite regress. Because, of course, the typical problem with an observer is who's observing the observer, right? If there's an observer observing this. And it's a nice example of population coding where there's very little information at the level of the individual, but the information is encoded in the population. So here you can ask, how big is the population, right? And that has to do with the resolution. In order to spell out, you know, you probably need on the order of a few hundred people, right, in order to spell out anything meaningful, right? Because if you just have a part of the bleachers, you know, with, let's say, 10 by 10 with 100 people, that's probably not high resolution enough to spell out letter. You probably need, I don't know, on the order of 1,000 people, or 10,000 people. And that's probably not that far removed from the number of neurons, I think, that you need to, you know, to have some, to see something. Okay, now those Clinton neurons are actually called grandmother neurons. So Clinton is the grandmother, we concluded. Grandmother neuron is just a popular technical term in the literature to donate, sort of there's a long literature that goes back to it where people argued, well, you have to have a neuron that encodes your grandmother, and you have to have one neuron for your grandmother smiling, for your grandmother dancing, for your grandmother, you know, holding the baby, and for your grandmother with glasses and without glasses. And isn't this extremely outlandish? So probably it was used as an argument against the idea that there could be such specific neurons because of permanent, because of combinatorial explosion, right? There are just too many things that you could see in order for this to be a plausible strategy. I think that's wrong. I think the brain pursues two strategies, or at least two strategies. One is for those things, I mean, if you just think what fraction of your time, what fraction of your day, you know, let's say 20 hours or 18 hours awake, what fraction of that is taken up by things you see each and every day? I mean, it's your house, you know, your room. You're in so many hours in your room or in your office or in your car, right? You're so many hours with the same people. And so, you know, I would say, you know, probably 95 plus of the time, you're surrounded by things that you see all the time. And so it makes a great deal of sense for the brain to wire those up sort of in hardware. And they're probably not more than, what, 1,000 or 10,000 or 20,000 different, probably many fewer different objects or people. And so if you dedicate 100 neurons, you know, you've got 100,000 neurons per cubic millimeter. Below a cubic millimeter of cortex, you've got on 10 to the 5 neurons. So you've got plenty of neurons. And then you have a second mechanism that you recruit for doing all those things that you only see rarely, right? To see the random person walking by, you can perfectly well do that. You have a broader mechanism. So you have these two mechanisms complementing each other. Yeah, there's this nice analogy, depth of computation comes from the theory of computation to make this, because people say, well, what, you know, what, can you make an exact computational definition of explicit versus implicit? It's difficult, like almost in biology, to make a rigorous definition, but the idea is the depth of computation is a measure that comes from theory of complexity that tells you how much processing you've done on something, or how much processing you have to do less if you, you have to do in order to get to a goal, so that would be the complement. So for example, if you look at tide tables, how many of you know what tide tables are? Okay, tide tables. Okay, so for those of you who live or grow up next to the ocean, before the internet, imagine that. Before the internet, they, you know, people wanted to know the tides. You know, if you're a sailor or fisher or beachcomber, you want to know when it's high tide and low tide. So in any good coastal newspaper, they publish tide tables where it says, you know, high tide is at, you know, 6:45 and low tide is at 12:45 or 12:43, whatever. You know, each day because they would shift with the moon. And so there you have a case, you have an explicit representation of the tides. Now, you also have an implicit information. If I know where the, you know, where the sun and the moon is, and I know where tides were yesterday, then of course, using some simple math or Fourier transforms, I can calculate, you know, I can calculate where the tides will be, or I can do it from Newton's first law and knowledge of the local geography. I can calculate it. So here you have a case of some information that's made explicit, and it's very useful. You can see it's much more useful. That's the idea behind depth of computation. It's much more useful if the information is explicit, because then I can directly use it to do something else, right? So in this analogy with this TV, if I want to know whether there's a person there, well, if the LED has already done all the work for me, the LED lights up and is red, I know there's a person there. If I just see the individual pattern, then I have to do some further computational processing in order to determine is there a person there. So likewise with the brain, that if a neuron fires, let's say in a high-level part of the brain, it says that Bill Clinton is out there. That's incredibly useful information. I can directly use that. Well, if I'm looking at the retina, that same pattern of photons, of course, strikes the retina, but there it's not yet very useful because I still have to do all that task. There's the logical depth of computation at the level of photoreceptors or ganglion cells, the output of the retina, is still very little. They haven't done a lot of processing yet. They've discounted some simple things like the overall brightness and intensity, but they haven't done the computational, all the sophisticated computation that you need in order to extract actually the face or even to identify Bill Clinton. Yeah, and then it makes sense to us, to Crick and me, that we have this activity principle that says, what I said already before, that underlying every direct and conscious perception is an explicit representation. So by direct, I mean something that you can directly see. You can all directly see this. You can all directly see my face. You can indirectly infer that that there's a back of my head, right? You cannot directly perceive my back. I mean, now you can, but you can't this way, right? Now you can infer that I have a back of my head because it would strike you as unreasonable if I didn't have one, because you haven't really seen any people that don't have something at the back of their head. But I mean, that's the idea. I can infer, for example, the fact that there's nothing behind me. I can infer the existence of the blind spot, right? I mean, there's a spot here, roughly here, where I don't see anything. Well, sorry, that's wrong. There's a spot here where my eye doesn't get any input, for example, my right eye. I can infer that. I don't perceive that directly. So everything I can directly perceive, there's going to be an explicit representation. And if there's no such explicit representation for some feature, then you're not conscious of it. And this explains those number of clinical syndromes, one of which I referred to already today, prosopagnosia. What happens in this prosopagnosia? Remember, it's the inability to perceive faces. Well, the person has lost, usually to a stroke, sometimes to a virus or gunshot or some other calamity, but usually a stroke. He has lost the neurons that represent faces, and therefore you don't see a face anymore. You can infer that's a face by saying, well, there's an eye, there are two eyes, there's a nose, and I know from everyday knowledge that if there are two eyes and a nose there, it's got to be a face, but that's very different than perceiving it. There's a very rare patient, or two very rare patients, who have what's called akinetopsia. There was one patient in 1917 in Germany and another one in 1980. She just died recently. Akinetopsia, absence of knowledge about kine, about motion. So what this patient has, she's bilateral lesion. It's very rare because you need to have the area knocked out on both sides of the brain. She's unable to see motion. It's difficult to imagine what that would be. So she can clearly see things that move, but she cannot see motion. So she can see a car is far away and the car is close by, but she doesn't see it in motion. So to me, as I mentioned last time, the simplest analogy is in a disco strobe light. You know, when you see people dance, when you see the dancers, you see them like this, and you see them like this, but you actually never see the transition. So it's like this person is seriously impaired, or she was, as I mentioned, she's dead. She was seriously impaired, but she could see stereo and she could see color. So there wasn't anything wrong with her eyes or with the visual system per se. She could infer motion through the change in position. So, you know, you can also see, you know, if it's here and now it's here, you know, clearly the position has changed and it covers more of the visual field than here, so I can infer from that it's moving. But there's no evidence that this lady ever saw any motion. So that's pretty bizarre because we just don't know how such a world would look, and it's fortunately very rare, but there you have a case of prosopagnosia, of akinetopsia. Other cases are achromatopsia, absence of color vision. So there's nothing, we of course all know that there's some, in fact, some guys, I'm pretty sure here that there'll be some of you guys who have, you know, who lack either the long or the medium range, the green or the red photoreceptor. But these are people who have normal vision. In fact, Oliver Sacks described one of them as a painter. These are people who have normal color vision. They can normally see normal colors. And then at some point, you know, when they get older, they have a stroke. And in some cases, when the stroke is localized, they might just lose color vision. In fact, you can even lose it only in one hemifield, which is truly, so now you see everything that's to the right, that's your fixation, you see in color, and everything over here is black and white. It's pretty bizarre, right? But it is described in the literature. Interestingly, people don't seem to notice that. It's also another interesting fact. You would think it's a huge jarring, you know, if this is black and white, this is color, but for whatever reason, people adapt or whatever, people don't tend to notice it unless it's tested explicitly. So here you have people who can see wavelength differences, but they're unable to see color. And I'm trying to remember, I don't know actually whether they dream in color or whether they also would dream with half the visual field. I assume they would. It's a good question. Good question, do they dream in color or not?
I think the painter dreams in black and white.
Well, probably it depends on time. I've talked to blind people who were born sighted and then lost sight over many years. And what happens there, well, there's a there's a diversity of responses. So in some of them, they lose vision after a while. After a few years, they don't even use imagery anymore. They totally lose it. So maybe that's what happened there. While other people still see, I mean, they can still have very vivid imagery, and they continue to see, I mean, using their mental eyes, they never lose it. So probably has to do with the age at which you had the injury. Of course, there are some people who are born totally without color. They're called achromatopes. They don't have any color representation whatsoever. Again, this all has to do with explicit representation. If you have an explicit representation, you can be conscious of that. And if you lose that, then you might be able to infer that, but you're not conscious of that feature of the environment that's represented in an explicit manner. So again, this really points out the local nature of conscious of the NCC, that you do not need the entire brain, that there can be local groups of neurons or areas of neurons or regions or neighborhoods of neurons that are responsible for one particular conscious attribute. And if you lose that, then you lose that attribute. Of course, still doesn't explain it doesn't explain the transition from neurons firing to vivid percepts. All it tells you, it's got to be sometimes some local property. Here, for example, you all see a triangle? Yeah? Can you all see Elvis? Hello, it's a joke. Okay, so here you can all see this triangle, although physically, there's nothing here, right? But you all can see very vividly this illusionary triangle named after the Italian Canisa, who sort of pioneered these, who discovered or invented these figures. And the claim is that you don't have to infer this. You don't have to say, well, there's probably a triangle that covers up those three Pac-Man. No, you directly see it. And so the claim is there are neurons that directly respond to that. And we'll come back to that in a couple of, because people have found neurons that do that. Okay, so there's this clinical term that somebody, a quite famous guy called Seamus Zeki, who's one of the pioneers of the exploration of cortex beyond primary visual cortex, Seamus Zeki in London. He coined this term essential node. It's a clinical term. It comes from clinical use. So if you lose the essential node for color or for motion or for faces, then you lose that associated concept. You're unable to perceive it. Another very specific one, there are some people who lose a part of the brain that I mentioned already, amygdala, and there was a recent speaker who talked about it. And then one of these syndromes is that these people are unable to perceive fear. They're unable to perceive fearful visual stimulation. So, for example, a fearful face doesn't evoke any fear. Or when they look at some imagery, for example, of mutilated people or horrible accidents, they don't have any fear. They don't have any of the negative affect that most normal subjects have, although they have all the other range of affect. So again, here you have another case of, in this case, the amygdala that seems to be an essential node for specific fearful or fear-related visual expressions or visual scenes. So I guess a little bit like Siegfried in Der Ring des Nibelungen. They don't know what fear is. That's not quite true. Because in principle, if you talk to some of those patients, or if you read about them, they in principle these patients do know what a fearful situation would be. They just don't find these visual things at all fearful. While they understand what it is, they know what it is, they can read it cognitively, but they have lost the ability to perceive this fearful stimuli based on visual input. Okay, so let me come to the last part today. We have to talk a little bit about the neural code. So as I mentioned already, the action potential is a universal communication protocol used. We don't know the exact code, but it's action potential. So it's a binary asynchronous communication protocol. And it's unlikely to be a single canonical communication code. As I said, different animals, even the same animal in different parts of the brain, or maybe even in the same part of the brain, depending what the exact nature of the task is, might use different codings. We'll spend in 2 weeks from now, there's some beautiful examples where you can precisely, quantitatively relate the nature of the code in a part of the brain of a cortex called MT or V5, a motion area, to perception and behavior. You can do it in a very rigorous quantitative way. It's been done by somebody, Bill Newsom at Stanford and his collaborators, and I'll talk about that. So certainly it's clear that the simplest of all code is a firing rate code, where you just count how many action potentials there occurred over a given time window, which might vary. That's the rate. It's a scalar number. It says, over the last second, there were 20 spikes, the neuron spike 20 hertz. Over the last 100 milliseconds, there were, 3 spikes. It might depend on the time scale. That's neuron is a firing rate code. That's sort of the simplest code. You can simulate it like a, for those who do theory of dynamical stochastic system, it's a random process, like a Poisson process, where you have one variable, lambda, the rate. And we can all agree, all neuroscientists agree that that's going to be the basic code, and there are lots of evidence, and I'll discuss some of them in future lectures, where you have a very quantitative relationship between the firing rate, whether neuron fires 100 spikes per second or 20 spikes per second, and behavior. But that's probably not the only game in town, and there's a great deal of excitement over the last 10 years, and I'm going to finish with that today. So there are at least two other possibilities for code that people are very actively investigating, and those are just two out of a huge spectrum of different types of codes. So people discovered or rediscovered this, that here you have at the top, you have four signals. At the top, you have the local field potential. So think of it like the EEG, except it's not taking on top of the head like your EEG is, but below, it's inside the skull. You have an electrode, and you record one signal. It's a broadband signal over hundreds of hertz bandwidth, and that's the local potential. And then below in the second row are the actual action potentials. But over high time scales. Now we zoom out, we look at the final time scale, 20 milliseconds. And then what you see here, that in this case, for example, the EEG is actually quite regular. It fires roughly with a periodicity we can see of like 20, 25 milliseconds. So because very often the oscillations are in the range of 40 hertz, 30 hertz, 50, 60 hertz, they're called 40 hertz oscillations, a shorthand. It's not 42, it's 40. These are known as the 40 hertz oscillation. So there is a propensity, for reasons we don't really understand, of particular cortical neurons to fire in this range of 40 hertz. And you can also see that if you zoom in at high scales, here you see, you can see it's not a clock, right? It's quite irregular. Here it may be like 40 milliseconds, and here it's probably, like 10 milliseconds, here it's 15 milliseconds. But clearly there seems to be a regularity to it. So here you have 3 or 4 action potentials at fire, 1, then nothing, then 1, then, maybe 2, then 3, then 2. So clearly, both the local field potential, which sort of represents the global activity of lots of neurons in that neighborhood, and here you're looking at 2 or 3 neurons firing, both of them seem to fire with this periodic component. Now, you might know from having read something about EEG, so when people first did this, when Berger did this in, the 20s and early 30s of the last century, if you put an electrode on your top of your skull and you amplify and you repeat things, you can see this sort of wavy pattern of electrical activity. And that's quite predictive of certain gross physiological stages. Like, if you're well relaxed, it's, beta. And then if you open your eyes, you can go into alpha range. And of course, in deep sleep, you get different oscillation, delta oscillation. In non-REM sleep, you get these very slow oscillation in 4 to 6 range. And sometimes you can get, when you're doing difficult tasks, like cognitive tasks, you get this gamma. This is also known as gamma range oscillation. It's between 30 and 50 hertz or something like that. So we all gotten used to the idea that brain discharges can be periodic. Of course, we continue to have no idea what this brain wave means. They're very crude because they average probably literally over millions of neurons, if not more. And it's been almost impossible to try to infer something more detailed about the brain states from EEG recordings. Just too crude of a technique. Anyhow, the fact of the matter is sometimes neurons do have these very specific rhythms. There's a great deal of excitement. And of course, we have here Gilles Laurent in the locus who has similar rhythms in 20 hertz, and Thanos Siapas here who studies these things at the theta range and also at this gamma range. But then even more interesting, when you're recording from 2 or more neurons, when you not put in one electrode, but let's say you put in 2 electrodes, and you record from 2 neurons. So the top 2 electrodes recalled, top two traces, top two rows recalled from one neuron, and the bottom two recalled from another electron, from another neuron, and again, here's the local field potential, here's individual spikes, you can see, and now this is for the same stimulus, so let's say you have a bar that moves, and the bar happens to cross both receptor fields of two neurons that you record from, that's how you arrange it. And those neurons both like the same, they both like the stimulus moving, let's say, from left to right. Then what you can see, lo and behold, that this and this neuron, they don't fire independently, but they seem to be synchronized. In a sense, where I put the arrows here, that every time you have one or two action potentials here, you also have a corresponding action potential there. Not always. I mean, again, this is you know, it's not computers, this is brains. So here, for example, you're not synchronized, but here you're synchronized, and here you're synchronized. And so this gave rise to a great deal of excitement, including Crick and I, who wrote an article, it's probably not right, where we claimed that this could be the critical correlate of consciousness, that the fact that neurons fire in a synchronized manner, that expresses a common property, which in this case relates directly to perception. So the idea was that of all the neurons, there are many neurons that fire to lots of stimuli. As I briefly alluded to last time, we'll talk about in depth later, most of the processing in your brain you're not conscious of. You're only conscious of a certain type of privileged, of some privileged neuronal state you're only conscious of. We don't understand why yet. And so one hypothesis that we express in that paper that's probably wrong is that privilege probably has to relate to the fact that neurons are synchronized, that all the neurons that code for motion of, I'm attending to this pen here and it's moving from left to right, all the neurons that code for it, they all fire in synchrony at the same time. It's a bit, think of it like a giant Christmas tree festooned with electrical lights, with electrical candles, you know, at Christmas, and they flicker randomly. So it's like a neuron fires, you know, randomly flickers 20 times a second, and you have this Christmas tree with, 20 billion candles, 20 billion lights that flicker on randomly. But now you have a subset of neurons that not only flicker periodically, every, 20, 30 milliseconds, but that also do it in a synchronized way. And why is it? Well, A, if you do, as an external observer, if you look at this Christmas tree, certainly it would be highly salient. This would immediately pop out. The biophysical argument is that you have, and we know those neurons exist, we have neurons that fire much stronger. If they get input, but the input occurs at the same time, that's more punch. So you have more postsynaptic punch. It's more stronger than if the input arrives dispersed in time. If the same two neurons fire, but this one comes, and then 10 milliseconds later, this one comes. They have the effect of the two, they cannot superimpose, and it's weaker than if both input comes together. And so the idea is that synchronization has a much stronger punch, is a stronger signal that can be picked up by other neurons, and this is one of the critical signatures of the neural correlates of consciousness. So I have to tell you, there's lots and lots of research, particularly in Germany by Wolf Singer. A lot of this experiment has been pushed by this group Engel, and the main key person there is Wolf Singer. And there's quite a bit of research by EEG and other people, people who use EEGs. The existence of these 40 Hz synchronized oscillations is not controversial anymore, but the interpretation remains highly controversial. Some of the best evidence for the relevance of these to perception comes from Gilles Laurent's lab here at Caltech from a locust, so it's unclear how that, if at all, relates to consciousness. But there you can show that you have synchronized oscillations in the sort of 20 Hz range, and that they seem to relate to encoding, to olfactory learning. It's been much more difficult and much more controversial for mainly technical methodological reasons. You've got only, orders of magnitude more neurons in the monkey brain. It's much more difficult to record from them, etc. Currently, the status of these synchronized oscillations, they certainly seem to exist, but many people, in the hands of many people, on the electrodes, I should say, of many people, they cannot find any. Sometimes neurons seem to oscillate in a synchronized manner, sometimes not. Some people say it's impossible to relate it to anything. We cannot relate it to anything, while other people claim, yes, it directly relates to perception. It remains very, very controversial, unfortunately. It's not that it's been solved, although these things were described in 1989, 1990. It's now 13 or 15 years. And in addition to other codes, people have proposed many more complicated codes. So the main idea I want to get across is that when people talk about neural activity, There might be different sorts of neural activity. We can all agree one aspect of neural activity is just the how loud neurons shout, essentially, right? The mean rate. If a neuron shouts very loud or if it's very quiet. Right? So we can all agree that's bound to be important. The question is whether there's additional information modulated on top of that. And it could be like, you know, does a neuron fire with a certain periodicity? Multiple neurons, do they fire synchronized? Or as some people have said, do you have pattern of neurons? Do you have pattern of action potential that extend across neurons? So neuron 1 fires two spikes, 5 milliseconds later neuron 2 fires, and 10 milliseconds later neuron 3 fires. That by itself could be a critical signal. And there are people like Moshe Abeles in Israel who've advocated these. And the trouble is the trade-off are the more sophisticated the code, the more information you can transmit in shorter time, right? The more powerful the network is. On the other hand, A, you have a problem with development, how does the brain develop these codes, and you have a problem with robustness, that those very fancy codes will tend to be much less robust than a simple code like a mean rate code. You know, if you have a mean rate code and you shift all the spikes by 2 or 3 milliseconds, it really doesn't matter. If one or two action potentials drop out because of some neurotransmitter failed to release, this happens all the time, well, you've got 45 or 42 spikes a second, really doesn't matter. You know, the gist of the idea is still that neuron fires strongly. So those are the trade-off, and that's a very active area of research that's happening. And there are many. And a couple of years ago, we used to do a lecture just on neural coding. Yeah. So that's the end of today's lecture. Thank you.